Signore e signori, buonasera. Buonasera. Welcome to New York University, Casa Italiana, Zerilli-Marimò. My name is Stefano Albertini. I'm the director of the Casa, and I'm delighted to have a chance to present here at the Casa tonight the Babylonian Talmud Translation Project. I was telling before to Professor Piperno that I had the fortune to be in the garden of the magnificent synagogue of Florence two summers ago when she presented the project. And I was there because a group of friends was performing with a concert. So I didn't know that that was going on. And I was so impressed by her presentation, the energy she put in it, and the ambition of the project, that I was completely fascinated and I wanted to know more. And little I knew that only 2 years later, I have the fortune of welcoming you here all at the Casa to talk about this project. Ambitious, because as you know, it's a monumental work, not translated in over 500 years. The technologies implied are super cutting edge that are going to be used also for many other projects to come. It involves a great number of scholars of different disciplines, from linguists to computer scientists. It's headed by a woman, Professor Piperno again. And so for many reasons, and for the fact that all in all, the Italian Jewish community is a very small community compared to many others, and it undertook this incredibly ambitious project. And I have to say also to the credit of the Italian government, with the support of the government for what turns out to be a fundamental project in the reconstruction of Jewish philosophical and theological thought. So for all these reasons, we are here to celebrate a great endeavor. We only saw the first volumes. There are many more to come. We have the fortune to have great speakers here tonight that I'm delighted to welcome to the Casa. But I have to leave the honor to formally introduce them to my dear colleague and friend, the executive director of the Centro Primo Levi here in New York, Dr. Natalia Indrimi. Thank you.
Everyone on earth had the same language and the same words. And as they migrated from the east and came upon a valley in the land of Shinar, they settled there. Come, let us build a city and a tower that will reach out to the heavens so we can make a name and it will be ours. Otherwise, we will be scattered all over the face of the earth. The story of the Tower of Babel is one of the first examples of reflection upon the idea that there is one meaning behind written and spoken words concentrated in one towering, imposing, vertical structure, and that this authority of the meaning is stable and unique and independent of its manifestations in sound and signs. And on the other hand, we have there on the horizontal horizon the languages, its material manifestations, the written and spoken words that are decentered and are lying behind this imaginary, unique, towering language. The relation between the unique, undivided language and the languages is a notion that has long fascinated humankind of all cultures and has been a source of mystery and investigation, a mystery from which much art has flourished, including the art of translation. The endless and highly imperfect practice of moving from one language to another, moving from one culture to another, is at the very core of our social being, is the way in which we generate meaning. I will leave to our distinguished speakers and guests the specific discussion on the translation of the Talmud into Italian and the languages in which it was translated before. I would like to only share some considerations on how translation lies at the center of the activity of Centro Primo Levi, an organization that has been active in New York for 20 years, and has really built its work on the idea of moving from one place to the other. I'd like to mention only a few senses, in a few directions in which translation is fundamental to us. We continuously translate from one language, from one of the many languages at whose intersection lies the history of Italian Jews. And we do this symbolically, and we do this practically through CPL editions that Alessandro Cassin directs, and the production of books and articles, our online magazine Printed Matter, all ways to bring texts that would not be available otherwise to a broader audience. There is another direction in which translation is essential to our work, and is that it is a key element in the understanding of power relations. This was an important point in Primo Levi's work that has shaped the work of our center. Arnaldo Momigliano, the great historian, summarized this point very well in a famous sentence in which he said, "The Greeks only spoke Greek, but it was up to the Romans to decide whether they wanted an interpreter." And this pretty much, I think, gives a sense of why and how this principle is a guiding element in our work. Translation is the gap between understanding or not, between being understood or not, between walking the road that will lead us to see something similar to the other or not, and the road of exchange. And because it is highly imperfect and ever-changing and somehow unattainable, it is a constant, it's a source of constant enrichment and dialogue, as Ariel Bloom put it. Even misreading is an enriching translation. In the particular case of the translation of the Talmud into Italian, there are two elements that really captured our imagination when we were invited to participate in this presentation. And one is that this is a collective work, is a collaborative work, is a way to work on this very complex road of moving from one place to the other, from one language to the other, and do it as a team of people with different sets of knowledge, different background. But it's also a collaboration between man and machine, something that lies in a very ancient world of dream and fears in all cultures. How do we, once we have created machine, the robot, what will it do to us? We can work with it, or with him, or with her, or with them, or whatever this computer will be. And I think that the Traduco project, and we have here Emiliano Giovannetti, I just want to also acknowledge his work in the technical part of the project. The space that the Traduco project creates, a space where science and humanities meet, where differences and meaning are challenged, and is a space that is highly horizontal, like the Tower of Babel, and I think is very much in the spirit of the century that we have just begun and we hope to continue. I'd like to give a few thanks. First of all, Stefano Albertini and his phenomenal team, our longtime partners with whom we have built a real presence of Italian Jewish studies in the American academia. Clelia Piperno, who is the head of the Talmud Project, and I must thank you. This was a phenomenal idea, and I think it deserves a real appreciation from a broad audience. Our guests from me, Rabbi Segni, Rabbi Mintz, and Sally Fisher, who dedicated herself with great talent and great patience to this presentation. A few words on our speakers. Rabbi Riccardo di Segni is the chief rabbi of the Jewish community of Rome, is the vice president of the Conference of European Rabbis and the director of the Italian Rabbinical Academy, the Collegio Rabbinico Italiano. In the best tradition of Italian Rabbanim, is a medical doctor. Many years ago in the past century, I was at an event in which you welcomed for the first time in Rome, Rabbi Adin Steinsaltz. And never would I have thought that I would have the honor to welcome you in New York as Chief Rabbi of Rome and in this prestigious place. And I want to say, from there to here, there is a continuous line, and we have to thank you for the work you're doing to address very important issues of Judaism today. Rabbi Adam Mintz is a modern Orthodox rabbi in New York and teaches in many different venues. His teaching actually has created a real network of exchanges and conversation in different environments, which is something very valuable and important. He's a professor of Jewish studies at City College and a member of the Talmud faculty at Yeshivat Maharat. His essay on Talmud in translation that was published years ago on the occasion of a fabulous exhibit on the Talmud that was at the Center for Jewish History touches upon crucial historical and normative aspects of translating this very particular work, and that is so representative of Jewish culture and history. And I hope that today we'll be able to bring some of that very important context to this stage and to our public. Without further ado, I just want to invite everybody. We have at the Center for Jewish History, the Rome Lab is a special project of the Jewish Museum of Rome that will be housed here on 16th Street until January. We have programs almost every night in collaboration with Stefano Albertini and Casa Italiana Zerilli-Marimò. Please come. They're all very interesting, all different topics of Roman Jewish history, and always some good conversation to have afterward. So thank you very much for being here tonight, and please welcome our speakers.
Okay, we are here to talk about this project, which started very casually some years ago when Clelia was talking with me and said we should do something very interesting, very okay. What you suggest? She said, okay, we could translate the Talmud in Italian. Are you crazy? Do you understand how much work it needs? How much money is needed? We cannot do this by ourselves, with our tools, people, and also money. So she said me, I will manage to solve this problem. And I said, okay, do. Because I was sure she will not do it. But she managed and to talk with the government to establish links. It was very, very difficult at the beginning. It is still very difficult, at the beginning we had some problems of definition, legal definition, agreements, discussion within the community, discussion outside the community, so many things we did. Now the problems are different, but always there are problems with this huge project. Anyway, it's here. We published the first volume, which is Rosh Hashanah. The question is, why Rosh Hashanah? And the answer is, first of all, it's a short treatise. So we wanted to work on a short treatise because you can have the result with less difficulties. Second reason is that the Talmud was burnt in Rome in the day of Rosh Hashanah, on the 1553. So that it was a kind of symbolic renaissance. Then we worked on this. Everybody asked, why did you start with Rosh Hashanah? The answer is, why we shouldn't start with Rosh Hashanah. Okay. Now, the printing of Brachot in two volumes. It will be more than 800 pages. Is now in the printing house. So in a few days we will have it. And as you know, the Talmud is 2,700 dapim pages, foils. We up now translated about 1,000, but the translation is only the first part of the work, because after the translation we need to review the translation from several point of view, from the editorial point of view, from the rabbinical point of view, and from the Italian point of view, and each one makes a revolution on the result. So it took a long time to review all the things. Then the role passes to the editor-in-chief of the volumes, who again works on this. So it took a lot of time. At least we have a basis, a strong basis of about 1,000 dapim for translate. This is the point now. Now, I prefer not to be discuss. Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the invitation. And it's an honor to be up here on the stage and in a discussion with the Chief Rabbi. I just want to begin by pointing out, the Chief Rabbi pointed out that the Talmud was burnt in Rome on Rosh Hashanah 1553. But I would suggest that an even more meaningful moment is the fact that the Talmud was first printed in Italy, in Venice, in Venezia, in 1521. And the project to print the Talmud was actually a joint project. The person who owned the printing house and whose name is always associated with the printing of the Talmud is Daniel Bamberg. But of course, Daniel Bamberg had many Jewish associates. And it was those associates who figured out exactly how to lay out the page of the Talmud. We know what Daniel Bamberg's Talmud looked like. First of all, there are copies of Daniel Bamberg's Talmud, not many, but a few copies of Daniel Bamberg's Talmud available, not available to purchase, but available to see in certain places, both here and in Europe and in Israel. But I comment about Daniel Bamberg and the printing of the Talmud because actually there's a direct line between that event in Venezia in 1521 and this amazing event here, the translation of the Talmud into Italian. And that line is a straight line. Because when you open up the volume of the Italian translation of the Talmud, the way it's set up is that there's a traditional Talmud page, and on the opposite page is an Italian page. The traditional Talmud page is exactly the same Talmud page as Daniel Bamberg had in 1521. It's set up, it's arranged, it's divided just the way Daniel Bamberg set it up and divided it. Though with all credit to the chief rabbi, they made one addition, and that is they added vocalization, they added dots, so it's easier to pronounce the words in the Talmud. That definitely, I think Daniel Bamberg would agree that that was a positive contribution. So it's really an honor to be able to be here and to continue the work of Daniel Bamberg from so many centuries ago. And as we look, Chief Rabbi, at this translation, and as we heard in the introduction, I really wanted to discuss with you two pieces of the work. The first piece has to do with the translation, and the second piece has to do with what you call in the introduction the technology, the brilliance of constructing the page and the book the way that you did. Let's start with the translation. There's a famous rabbinic discussion about the first translation in Jewish history. The first translation in Jewish history was not of the Talmud, but of the Torah. It was the translation into Greek in the 3rd century in Alexandria in Egypt. And there are two different versions of the rabbinic teaching. One version talks about the miracle of the translation. The king, the Greek king, he collected 70 great Jewish scholars, put them in 70 different rooms. And what's the miracle? That these 70 Jewish scholars actually agreed with one another. And they translated the Torah exactly the same.
But they say that it could have been a much more important miracle if they were put together to translate, okay.
Yeah, that's exactly right. The king, King Ptolemy, was very smart. He knew that if he put them together, there was no way they would have gotten along. So that tradition sees the translation as a miracle and clearly as a very positive contribution. But there's another tradition that sees the translation not as a miracle. But the rabbis teach us that the day that the Torah was translated into Greek was as tragic as the day that the Jews worshiped the golden calf. Because, as the rabbis say, the Torah cannot be translated kol tzarka, adequately, according to its need. And I want to just, again, following the introduction, I want to ask the chief rabbi how, in the process of translation, how did you deal with this tension between the miracle of this volume, the fact that for the first time the Talmud is translated into Italian, and this is just the beginning of an unbelievably monumental project that will teach Talmud to Italian-speaking people for centuries to come. The miracle with the challenge to translate kol tzarka adequately according to its need.
Okay, as you stressed, there is a basic controversy in Jewish sources about the possibility of translation. This is a controversial point. And what about the Talmud? It could be even more controversial because the Torah, we're talking, the translation of the Bible is Torah Shebichtav, written Torah. And Talmud is oral Torah. And we should be much more careful about transmitting the teaching of oral Torah, not carefully, because what's the risk? The risk is that someone would take this point to make not authorized use of it. Behind the polemics on the translation, we should understand that there is a specific point on the birth of Christianity. Christianity is based on the Greek translation of the Torah. So the sages were skeptical about the result of a translation if the result is the birth of a new religion. Now, what's the point about the Talmud? I think we would not have the courage to start this edition without some important precedent, which is the precedent what has been done here in the United States. The Talmud has been translated into English. First, in the past century, there is a classical tradition, translation, then the monumental Schottenstein tradition, which is a tradition, translation into English. So you ask, who authorized this very Orthodox rabbi to make such work? Probably they suppose that the target, the main users of the translation would be the Jews of the widespread American community, who are a little bit far from the sources. So the main reason was to make easier the approach to the Talmud. So among these controversial points, the choice is between open the sources to make wider the number of people who study, or close and prefer the traditional way. You cannot solve the problem just a regular hat, but that's at the point. So you will not find the solution, but the fact that Schottenstein edition, and after this the Steinzer edition, had such an enormous success, it means that there is need for this.
Thank you. Chief Rabbi, I'm going to let you in on a little secret. When the editors of the Schottenstein Talmud, before they began their project, they went to Israel to speak to several very Orthodox rabbinic scholars to ask for their blessing on the translation of the Talmud into English. And they got mixed reviews. Some of the rabbis were very excited about it. Some of the rabbis said, no way. And they quoted this tradition about the fact that the Torah could not be translated kol tzarka adequately. And actually, the editors of the Schottenstein Talmud reached a compromise. If you take any volume of the Schottenstein Talmud and you open the very first page, the word translation does not appear. They use a fancy English word, elucidation. I don't know what elucidation means. Elucidation means translation. It means explanation. The key is that the word translation is not used. And that was the compromise with the rabbis in Israel, because they said you cannot translate the Talmud into a foreign language. The best you can do is to elucidate the Talmud. Now, I want for a moment to move to the next question. And that also has to do with the 20th and now 21st century. Your volume of the Talmud, much like the Schottenstein volume of the Talmud, is a technological masterpiece. Something that never would have been possible even 30 or 40 years ago. When you open the volume of the Talmud, not only do you find the translation into Italian, but you have the translation in bold letters and the elaboration in regular font. And then on the bottom, you have an amazing collection of notes. You have biographies that make these rabbis of 1500 years ago literally come to life. You have halakha, you have legal discussions about some of the issues discussed on that page of the Talmud. And you have the most amazing illustration and diagrams. I can't even begin to imagine how you were able to put together those illustrations and diagrams that make the most difficult pages of Tractate Rosh Hashanah come to life and be understandable. But maybe the most amazing advantage of this volume is the following. Let me explain. The problem is like this. When Daniel Bamberg arranged the page of the Talmud, he didn't imagine that it was going to be translated into any language. And therefore, he fit as many words as he could onto each page of the Talmud. It only makes sense. Now, in deference to that tradition, to that Italian tradition, you as the Schottenstein, you just like the Schottenstein volume, have decided to maintain the traditional page. The problem is, and this is a problem in the English Schottenstein as well, it's impossible to have an entire page of the original text translated on only one page, one facing page. It takes several facing pages, especially since what you do so beautifully are the notes and the diagrams and the pictures and the biographies. So it takes several pages. For any studier of the Talmud, that is a nightmare because you don't know what to do, right? You have the same page of the Talmud repeated three or four times, and you have different translations. You don't know where you are, where to start and where to stop and where to begin and where to end. But you figured out something that is brilliant. And I'll start to tell you what the Schottenstein did and why you have a better approach. What the Schottenstein did, again, the same problem as in English. What the Schottenstein did was they have a gray line down the side of the page of the Talmud. And it's only that the material at that gray line that's translated on the facing page. You have to turn the page, and then there's another gray line, and that's translated. And then another gray line, and that's translated. It works, but if you study the Schottenstein enough, the gray line isn't always evident. You kind of look down the page to find the gray line. It's a little cumbersome for the student. But in the Italian translation, you've done something so much smarter. And that is that you have numbers on the original Talmudic page. And then on the facing page, you have the number, the paragraph that's being translated. So you have one, and then you have one, the translation, and two, sometimes on the same page, and then you have paragraph two in nice, what I would call in English, bite-sized chunks. In nice, you know, in nice lengths, not long like the Schottenstein sometimes has it, but in paragraphs that can be divided very well. And therefore, I have to admit that I don't know Italian. So I couldn't really study the Rosh Hashanah volume. But I know enough about Talmud to know that if I knew Italian, the way that the pages are arranged is really a masterpiece and brilliant. And thank God, and this is the way it always should be, an improvement over the Schottenstein.
We'll say this to the shortest thing, okay? But the main technological part is the use of a centralized, computerized system, which was done by the technicians of the Center of Computerized Linguistics, which is in Pisa, a specific institute for this. So we gave them what we need. And they built this system. So this system allows everybody from every part of the world, from a home, from the office, at any time in the day, to open the page, to see the smaller unit that they have to translate. He put on the other column the translation, then push the button, the translation is accepted, but you need to correct it. You have all the option to correct it, to put bold, to put italics, to insert notes, to make the specific indexing, like names, concept, and so on, everything on the table. And that, and the other fundamental part is that you push the button on the line, and you can see the same sentences, the same segment, string, that has been already translated by other translators. So you have the, if you accept this, you can automatically take the translation into your translation. So with work in progress, you have, you know that in the Talmud there are many repetitive sentences. So you can use the work of the other translators to put in your. And it is an incredible source. Then you have another button that you push, and you can see all the corruption that has been done from the beginning. So if the first translator wrote in this way, and the other changed, you have also the signature who changed it. So you know who is the responsible of a beautiful correction or of a disaster. It is an incredible tool, which can be used for any kind of translation. You can translate from any language to to any other languages. You can use in English, Asian, Spanish, and so on. So this is a new thing. And this is due also by the idea for this was given by the promoters of the Minister of the Culture of the Italian government. They didn't want to support just a Jewish work because it's not so fair, okay? They wanted to support a scientific collaboration between several agencies. So they say that okay to support the Jewish community in this big enterprise, but you also to develop a specific scientific area, which is the area of the computer, by the structure, the organized structure in Italian culture. So you make a joint venture. And this works. It works. And this is also the new, you say that 30 years ago could have been possible. Now it's possible. Okay.
Thank you so much, Chief Rabbi. I just want to first of all, a comment on the idea of collaboration. So in 1521, when Daniel Bamberg translated the Talmud, the reason that the printing house was owned by Daniel Bamberg is that Jews did not have permission to own printing houses in Venice in the 1520s. And therefore, the printing house had to be owned by a non-Jew. So actually, in a kind of similar way, it was a collaborative effort between Daniel Bamberg and the Jewish editors who worked for him, and the Venetian government who gave permission to Daniel Bamberg, who allowed the Jews to translate the Talmud to give us the Talmud that we have. But now I think there's a, you know, when I'm listening to the chief rabbi describe the sophistication that went into the creation of this program, of this computerized program, and that you could even see translations that were done by others, I can't help but think about the fact that in this way, Italy and New York really have something in common. Uptown, just about 170 blocks, is Yeshiva University. The motto of Yeshiva University is Torah Umada. Torah Umada means the study of Torah, the study of religious, of Jewish religion, together with Mada. Mada means science, but in today's world, Mada really means technology. And Yeshiva University and the Orthodox community represented by Yeshiva University here in New York really represents and champions the integration between Torah, Talmud in this case, and technology. The ability to use technology to make our Torah and to make our Talmud better. And where exactly did Yeshiva University come up with this idea of Torah Umada, of Torah and science and Torah and technology? And of course, the answer is in Italy. Because it was in Italy that we had already back in the medieval period, we had Jews who were studying Torah and who were going to the medical schools in the cities in Italy. We had the Jews who later on in the 18th and 19th centuries used their knowledge of Italian literature and other literature that helped them to interpret the Torah and interpret the Talmud. Italy has really been, for all of us, a model of what Torah and science and the integration between the two is all about. And therefore, what a wonderful next step in that combination of Torah, of Talmud, and technology, this translation. And what an amazing evening that we're able to celebrate this integration, this history of Italian Talmud study and American Talmud study here in New York City.
Just as a curiosity, is there a lexicon or a sort of concordance system built from this collaborative project?
Okay, this is the aim of the center of Berlin.
Not yet,
but it's one of the purpose. It's one of the purpose.
That would, I mean, the application would be immense.
A user can perform searches, of course, and we can show strings where the search words appear. So there are some sort of quick concordances, keywords in context.
Right.
So we simply show the strings, the sentences where the search words appear. So it's something very similar to standard concordances, and they can be used to make searches inside
source
and translations to understand how to.
Why don't you stand up and just let
okay.
The audience know?
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Introduce yourself.
I'm Eliano Giovannetti, and I'm a researcher in Pisa. So, this is what you can probably
as standard concordances that are typically used and adopted when studying a text.
Okay.
Of course. So, the text is already segmented in strings, as Rabbi said. So the strings that are manually segmented by users, typically on punctuation dots. So the sentences are the atomic units composing the translation. Then they are grouped into logical units, so small, biggest, bigger chunks of text. logical units are grouped in blocks, and blocks form chapters and tractates. So it's a hierarchical structure which can be browsed in the, on a specific section of the system. And it's basically how it appears.
There is another advantage in their system that each day they may count how many strings have been translated, how many strings are being reviewed, how much this specific co-worker works or not work, it doesn't work. So it is a tremendous tool to check the people.
Conversations. There are a lot of discussion on rabbinical issues that arises from this, from the translation. Can you give us an example of something that was?
Okay, there are many examples. The examples. There is a broad spectrum of problems to find the right Italian word to a specific problem. I can tell you, for example, there is a rabbinical, very common expression in Hebrew is yatsa yedechovato or lo yatsa yedechovato. It means that you fulfilled your duty or not. So in our schools, among the Italian Jews, we always translated this literally. È uscito d'obbligo o non è uscito d'obbligo? It came out. Oh. But Italian speaking people told us that this expression is not used in Italian. It's not Italian, uscire d'obbligo. So what we do with this? So we have to. So we tried to transform each occurrence in. Ha realizzato l'obbligo o adempiuto l'obbligo, non ha adempiuto l'obbligo, in correct Italian. But anyway, someone who translated is much more traditional, says no.
Really, because then when someone studies yes. Partial translations or commentaries from the Italian tradition, has to be able to refer to this thing.
Anyway, so this is a very simple example. Then how do you translate specific word? We are the most important translator into European language is Rashi, who has plenty of loazim, which are mainly French words. Sometimes his translator, his translations don't fit with the Italian translation, with the Italian tradition, which is a little bit older, the Aruch, the dictionary of the Talmud. So in some case, we want to rely, or at least to quote also that there is a different Italian identification. Let's give an example. Among the cereals, the five species was cereals, there is one which is called Shibolechual in Hebrew, which is commonly intended, identified with the oat. But the, according to the Aruch, it's not oat, it's rye, it's segala. It says segala. This is important because there are so many rules about the cereals. It is related also to the problem of the celiac disease today. This so when there is this different tradition, we stress that we want to put also the specificity of.
So someone is able to actually read the traditional yes, okay. Oh, okay. Text.
Yes, yeah, we.
We have time for just a question or two from the audience. Yes.
Wow.
Closer.
Closer and louder.
Rav Diseni, who are the people who are translating for you? And are they sitting everywhere around the world? And can someone who speaks Italiano in New York help along with that project? And who are you availing yourselves of other translations, for example, English translations, to help in the Italian translation?
Okay. One of the challenge, and also the result of this work, is to create a network of translators. In order to be a good translator of the Talmud, you need to be, first of all, a good student of Talmud. You need to know, okay. So you need a curriculum of studies in yeshiva or in the rabbinical school. Second, you must know a good Italian. So if you put the two things together, you have just this is the main difficulty of our project, because many translators knew good Italian and less Talmud, and many translators knew good Talmud and less Italian. So we have to translate their Italian into Italian. And another problem, our people, this is young people mainly, young or not less young people, who maybe they are, they studied many years in yeshiva, many of them are in Israel, but they studied Lilmot. Lilmot is not the same thing of Lilamed, to teach, to study and teach at. And for them, it's difficult to dress as people who have to explain to someone who never studied. Because the aim is to explain Talmud to people who came from the desert and don't know anything. So at the beginning, our group was small. Many came in, many came out with a continuous circulation, but the advantage of the system that now we are working to create, to develop people. So it's turned to be a school. It's turned to be a school. One other solution, which is not so practical now, is to take a young student, which not so much experience of Talmud, to put him together with a teacher who may be a teacher from everywhere, an Israeli teacher who speaks only Hebrew, who explaining to him, who teaches him the daf, and then the student writes the translation. We have to check it many times, but so you make a school. So for United States, it could be obvious. You have a lot of people who study Talmud. Thousands. Hundreds of thousands, I don't know, but at least thousands. So you can find people. In Italy, it's not so easy. So the advantage of the system is to create a school.
Thank you.
We have time for one more question.
Sign of help. I mean, I think with all the comparison with Venice, I think it's a good opportunity to say a community. I don't think it happens in many other communities of the size of the Italian one. So what is the meaning of this about the health of the Italian community?
If we start from a very traditional point, to make translation is not a sign of health. Because it means that you are far from a tradition. If you start to make a translation of a prior book, it means that people don't understand the prior book. But at the present moment, to make a translation it means that they are going the opposite way and to restore something. Okay. So I think that this is one of the best results of the production of the Italian Jews in the last years. The attention of the Italian Jews is so concentrated on issues of identity or anti-Semitism. You know what happened today or 2 days ago? This is makes us crazy. All our resources are concentrated on this kind of work, which is absolutely disturbing. It's not our identity. It's something that comes from outside, and to work on our sources to make them available to people is, I think, is a great revolution, and it's a sign of good health.
Do we have any other?
Siamo alla conclusione. Before we invite you to join us upstairs for the reception that the Talmud Project is offering to you, and it's catered by Latanz, it's a kosher reception, I want to thank our guests, Rabbi Mintz, Rabbi Segni, our friends of the Centro Primo Levi. And I wanted to close this discussion with an episode that my friend Simonetta Della Seta told me, that once he was in Jerusalem, Cardinal Martini was the former Archbishop of Milan and a great admirer and scholar also of the biblical text, went to visit her and asked if she could introduce him to somebody to learn more about the Talmud. And she took him to visit Rabbi Adin Steinschultz. And he received the cardinal and Simonetta, and they were talking, and the rabbi showed him text, explained concepts, and then he stopped for a minute, and then he explained it in a completely different way. And he told him, you know, in the great Jewish tradition, but also in the Italian Jewish tradition, whenever you have a holiday, you sit at the table with all your friends and your family, and you eat, and you talk, and you eat, and you talk. And these conversations can go on for a long time, and they can be very complicated and sometimes very polemical. And then he stopped for a minute and he said, that's it. The Talmud is like sitting at the dining table with the Lord. So I think this is also a good invitation for us to continue our discussion with some good food. And thank you again very much to our friends. Thank you.